Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Sunday before Thanksgiving. This is such an exciting time of year, a beautiful time of year. Yesterday, what a gorgeous fall day we had, and it's good to be together again as God's people here in this place to just focus on the great and awesome, generous God that we belong to and who supplies all that we need. We're here to worship Him today. We're glad each and every one of you is here. And as you walked in this morning, you saw the bell tables here. Our dinglings are with us this morning. And they're going to be giving us our call to worship, a great arrangement of a great Thanksgiving song gathered together. So let the bells bless you and call you into worship of our great and generous God. Give me the victory. And he says, no. The victory is not mine. The victory is his. As this song says, it's not my life to live. It's not my song to sing. You know, we're up here, we're singing these songs. They're not our songs to sing. We just happen to be a way that the Lord is moving through us to give a message to you. It's not my righteousness, it's not my faithfulness. Probably the thing that struck me the hardest. It says, it's not my war to win, and it's not my weight to bear. He won the victory. And in all situations, in everything that we do, in the times that we are alone, the times we have this darkness surround us, it's his victory. We just get to enjoy it. So, as we sing this song, I don't know what everybody's going through this morning. I just know what I've been going through. And I know that the victory is his. It's not my life to Praise all in Jesus' name. Amen. knows. We love you and Amy and Ashley and Abby and Alyssa. We're so glad that you guys are a part of our church. Seeing you all up here playing bells too earlier, that's really cool. We're glad God brought you to Bethlehem. I went back to Calvary there. Where's my brain? Sorry, Bethel, sorry. Just get lost in it all here. But let's keep praying, all right? Father, it is so good to be together with your family, with brothers and sisters in Christ that have understood and known the awesome grace that you have given to us through Jesus. That in your grace we stand. In your grace we have power. In your grace we have victory. In your grace we have all that we need for all of life, every situation. You promise to give us everything we need. And you don't promise, Father, that we will walk through just all times of roses and ease. And in fact, your word and Jesus said there will be suffering. We will walk through hard things. But it is in those hard things that your glory is truly revealed. It is in those hard things that we find the strength that only you can provide. It's in those hard things, those times of suffering, that we find that your grace is sufficient. And so we want to give you the glory for that today. We want to celebrate that. We want to embrace that. We want to hang on to that. If some of us are really struggling today, help us to hang on to your promise, your great truth, that your grace will be there for all the things that we face. We pray for your power to be at work, Father, in the lives of our congregation, that your amazing grace that we just sang about will be displayed. And those that are struggling with health issues, those that are struggling with financial issues, relationship issues, concerns about jobs. Father, pour out your grace in our lives. We hold that up before you. All of us are here this morning coming from different places and in different situations, but every single one of us needs your grace and promise to give that to us because of Jesus. Today we want to pray for Katie. Father, we pray for your continued work in her body, that you will help her and Jay as they continue the new reality for them as Katie goes to dialysis each week, throughout the week. Thank you for your grace and your blessing and your help. We pray for your power to be at work in Katie's body and her spirit, for Jay as well. We also pray for Artis. Father, we continue to pray for healing in her body, restoration of her kidneys. Is our plea to you, Father. However you want to provide kidney function for her body, may your grace just pour out over her and Earl. And we ask for healing of that, Father, according to your will and for your glory. We pray for Willard Punt this morning, Father, as he's struggling just such a shortness of breath and dealing with the compromised lung function and heart function and kidney function, all of those things that are going on for him. Give him and Jackie special grace to deal with that. Fill them with your peace. And we pray, too, for your healing there. We pray for your comfort for Rich and his family as they walk through the time of losing Marlene. We want to thank you again for the joyous truth that Marlene is whole and completely restored and in your presence, experiencing the glory of Jesus. And the same is true for our sister, Jo Dinvesky, Father. Thank you for the life you gave her, 98 years here in this world, her faithful service to our congregation for so many years, even to her last days, Father. She was praying for us, praying for our church, praying for me, praying for individuals that she was aware of. Father, you used her right up to the end, and we thank you for her willingness to serve, to give herself, and pray for us. And now as you call her home, Father, our hearts just rejoice that she is with Jesus. She sees him face to face. And the one she's talked to all these years, she's talking face to face to him right now. We thank you for that. We pray for your comfort for Joe's family as they walk through this time of grief and loss as well. We pray that you give them all that they need for each and every day and as they walk through those feelings. Father, thank you that your spirit is present with us today. We pray that you will be glorified as we continue in our service, and we reflect on how great and awesome you are. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we sent out word about Joe DeVesti passing away this past week. Her funeral will not be until December 7th. So Saturday, December 7th is the date that they scheduled. The arrangements are at Vanderpoop Funeral Home. For those of you that, want to be a part of that, I thought it was kind of interesting and significant that they picked December 7th, Pearl Harbor Day. Part of the story of Warren and Joe DeVesti's life is Warren was in the Navy in World War II and served in the Pacific. And 4 years they were separated, didn't hear anything. And it was part of Joe's story. So I thought it was very interesting that they picked that date. Put that in your calendar if you want to make plans to be a part of that. Keep praying for the DeVesti family. I want to remind you of our open forum that is taking place after the service today. So head on out after the service, grab some coffee, cookies. There is a photo booth out there today. The photo booth has been brought to do Thanksgiving pictures with your families. If you want to do that, grab a cookie, some coffee or lemonade or hot chocolate maybe. I think Scott might have that. Take a family picture with the Thanksgiving props. And then after a while, you can gather back in here maybe, what do you think, Ryan, about 11? Gathering here for the open forum to hear responses to some of the questions that were raised at the round tables that we had last week. Share answers to those questions were in the open forum that we'll have after the service. Then I want to remind you, too, of the Thanksgiving Eve service that we have coming up. That'll be on Wednesday night, 7 o'clock, right here in the auditorium is our Thanksgiving Eve service, so plan to be a part that as well. And then we have had a generous week as Bethel Church. Bethel has been giving of time, talent, and treasure this past week to bless our community. First of all, it was the Unity Meal on Monday night. We've got some pictures of that for you. A bunch of you showed up, and then there were great volunteers. Here's Diane and some of the kitchen crew that was there that night, and some great helpers that pitched in. Hey, Paul Rose, what do you do there? And then we also had a great partnership with the Sheldon FFA. They donated all the turkeys, 20 turkeys, for the event, and there was a great crew of them there that worked hard, participated with us. It was really nice to have them there. And then 200 pounds of potatoes were donated, prepared, and served as part of the Thanksgiving meal that night. Tyann, do you have a number? I never heard a number from you for that night. How many meals?
262.
Ooh.
And 32 meals to go.
Wow, so almost 300 meals. Almost 300 meals were served that night. That's awesome. Praise God for that. Yeah, great group of volunteers that came out to be a part of that. And these weren't just skimpy little meals either. I mean, it wasn't just a little tiny piece of turkey, a little plop of potatoes. They heaped it on. There was generosity in the serving of the meals too. And then the very next night, we had our pink Thanksgiving boxes that we prepared to distribute to, I believe we prepared 16, but only 15 families were there that night. Only 15. 16 food boxes prepared with the Thanksgiving dinner. So there's some of the prep. We gathered in the youth house. That place was packed. We maxed it out. We used every inch of that space and more, I think. But a great group of Bethel people came out along with 15 families from the community that came. We had a meal together. And then we took the kids over to the north side of the youth house. It was nuts. I'm still a little after that. But it was okay. And then Carla Benheisen did some cooking demonstrations. So that, as Jessica mentioned, you know, people that, I've never cooked a turkey before. Here you give me a turkey. What do I do with this thing? Carla did some demonstrations on how to prepare the items that were in the food box. And that was really, I think she was sort of like Julia Child. And it just was a great night, blessing our community, loving on the folks that were there. Sorry, Carla. and just a really cool thing to be a part of. So, thank you to Jessica, Crime Break, Gina, Duncan, Carla Benheisen, and Rebecca. Rebecca Chrisman, they were the core group that pulled that together, and then all of you that volunteered that night to be a part of it. This couple up here that is joining us is my son Kent, my oldest son Kent, Ross's older brother, and his wife Marissa. They are here with us from Chicago. They got here on Friday night, 2:30 in the morning. They got here. They are young and a little bit crazy. But I was so excited to have them here for a few days on their way to California. So they are passing through and heading out west. They're going to bless us this morning with a song during our offertory. As we receive our morning offerings this morning, I hope it blesses your spirit and that you give with some of the joy that we have in the grace of God this morning. That joy prompts us to be generous and to just celebrate God's generosity to us. So give with a joyful, cheerful heart this morning as they share with us. So good to have you guys here.
How great, how great, how great.
guests are heading out to California. They've taken a call to a church there. Kent is going to be the worship pastor there at a church in Tracy, California. And that's where they are headed. They're going to start December 2, so next week, Monday, going to be starting out. Would you guys be so kind as our family here to help us bless our family and just pray God's blessing over them as they follow God's call and lead their life. If you just, if you're comfortable, extend your hand with us and pray over Kent and Marissa with us. Father, thank you so much for your love. How great is your love, Father? We can hardly even begin to fathom or comprehend it. You have shown your love to Kent and Marissa. You have provided a way and a calling, a path for them. And your grace has just been poured out on them. You've opened doors. You provided, made things go smoothly. And Father, we pray that that will continue for them. We pray that over them. That you will go ahead of them down the road, down Interstate 80 as they head west and head to the Central California, Father. Go ahead of them. Surround them with your guardian angels as they travel. Prepare the way where they will live, where they will serve. Open up hearts to them and surround them with your love the entire way. We pray your blessing and your anointing on their ministry. May it bring you great glory. May it call people to worship you and delight in you. May their hearts delight in you. May they be worshipers. May their lives, their marriage, their ministry give glory to you and be a blessing to many people, a blessing to your people. Pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Have mercy. God bless you guys. Love you. So glad you're here this morning. Appreciate you. Yeah, thank you, everyone. Thanks for humoring us, like Marissa. Ken, did you see where I put your music? All right, good. I don't want you floundering around up here. Come back. So today we're continuing our series of messages for the month of November called Generous God, Generous Living. And last week we spent some time looking at the way that Paul was seeking to encourage the Corinthian Christians to follow through on their commitment to give a generous offering for the impoverished believers in Jerusalem. In chapter 8 of 2 Corinthians, Paul told them about the amazing generosity of the Macedonian churches. And even though they were undergoing trials, severe trials is what Paul called them, and were dealing with severe poverty on their own. I mean, they were giving a gift to the impoverished Jews, but they had poverty of their own. And even though they were dealing with that trial and that poverty, their overflowing joy in the grace of God prompted them to give above and beyond what it seemed they were really able and capable of giving. And God's grace had filled them with joy, which overflowed in generosity and an incredible act of love for their fellow believers. And Paul shared that story with the Corinthian Christians, and he shares it really with us as well, to encourage us to respond in the same way. Respond in the same way to experience God's grace, to let that fill us with joy, and in turn, let that lead to generosity. That can be the experience of every believer, and Paul wants it to be. Well, in 2 Corinthians 9, Paul continues to encourage and motivate the generosity of the Corinthians. And we're going to look at verses 6 through 11 of 2 Corinthians chapter 9 this morning. Beginning in verse 6. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all you need, you will abound in every good work. As it is written, He has scattered abroad His gifts to the poor, His righteousness endures forever. Now He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be made rich in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion, and through us your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. What a great passage. What a great passage. There's so much to dig into in this passage. So we're just going to be doing some of that this morning. And we're going to begin with that very first verse, verse 6. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. And so right away here in verse 6, we see another example of that upside down nature of the kingdom of God. We've talked about this before, that the ways of God are often in direct are the direct opposite of the ways of humans. In God's kingdom, the first are last, and the last are first. In God's kingdom, greatness can be found in being a servant. In God's kingdom, what appears to be foolish to people is wise. It's upside down in the kingdom of God compared to the human experience and our expectations. It says in 1 Corinthians, Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, an example of that foolish and wise thing, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise man? Where is the scholar? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand miraculous signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than man's wisdom, and weakness of God is stronger than man's strength. Is Mike going dead? No, it's not. It's weird frequencies there. So the way things work in God's kingdom is often directly opposite of the way we as humans expect things to work. It's the same kind of thing here in verse 6 of 2 Corinthians 9 when it comes to giving. In our human thinking, we naturally think that if we give away more of what we have, we will have less. And if we give away less, we will have more. If I have $10 and I give away one, I'll have nine. And if I give away zero, I'll have 10. I'll have more if I give away less. But what Paul says is that if you give away more, you will have more. And if you give away less, you will have less. Thinking that we will have less if we give away more is logical and it makes sense in our minds, but that kind of thinking leaves out God. It leaves out God and His promises. God's promise says, if you subtract more seed from your bag, you have more than if you subtract less seed from your bag. Paul says, if you sow generously, you will also reap generously. If you sow sparingly, you will also reap sparingly. You have more if you give more. You have less if you give less. That's God's promise. That's God's promise to us, and He wants us to trust Him and believe that promise. That doesn't make sense in our minds. It's upside down, That's the way it works in the kingdom of God. We'll see more of this as we move along, but now let's look at verse 7. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. So in this verse, we see that God cares about the attitude of our heart. He cares about our feelings and our motivation when we give. Paul says that each person should give what he has decided in his heart to give. Notice that Paul doesn't just say each should give what he has decided to give. He says what he has decided in his heart to give. The heart is the center of emotions and affections and motivations. And the heart also has to do with the attitude of our spirit, the attitude and the spirit with which our giving is done. And Paul doesn't talk here about a dispassionate, methodical kind of decision. He's talking about a decision that has some motivation and some feelings behind it. We can see that that's what he means when he says that it shouldn't be done reluctantly or under compulsion. Now, the word translated reluctantly literally means from grief. From grief, it's like, oh no, I have to give again. It causes you grief to give. That's what it means. It's something you don't want to do. And that word under compulsion means that someone or something is forcing you to do something that you're not naturally inclined to do. Maybe it's maybe the compulsion is trying to follow the rules in order to avoid punishment. Many people relate to God this way. They don't want God mad at them, and they think that following the rules will avoid God's anger and punishment. And so they say, God wants me to give, so I better do it to stay on his good side. Well, that's compulsion. Or it may be that they're seeking people's approval. I want people to think well of me, to notice how much I give, and that kind of motivation is prideful. And so then the giving is done not because of a desire to give, but out of a compulsion to get the praise of people. Paul says, don't let those kind of motivations be what drives your giving. He says God loves a cheerful giver. A cheerful giver. God wants our giving to be done out of joy. Which is exactly what motivated the believers in Macedonia that we talked about last week. That's what motivated them to give, was their joy. Remember, Paul said that their joy in God's grace overflowed in generosity. They gave or they sowed bountifully out of their joy. And that's the kind of giving that God loves. That's the kind of giving that God delights in. Bountiful giving comes from a joyful, bountiful, cheerful heart. Not reluctant, forced giving. That's done sparingly, with a sense of grief, with the legalistic or prideful motives. So why does God love that kind of giving? He loves that kind of giving because it glorifies him. It brings glory to him. It points to the awesome, glorious God that he is. It points to the truth that he is generous, that he is trustworthy. It points to the transforming, life-changing work of his spirit in the hearts of people. I mean, cheerful, bountiful giving is not something we as humans are naturally inclined to do. We naturally want to get and keep. God's grace and his spirit working in us cause us to see things with eyes that are oriented to that upside down nature of the kingdom of God. And we go from thinking that if we give more, we will have less, to understanding that with God, we will have more if we give more. Cheerful giving shows that we trust God and believe that. And God helps us do that. He gives us ample reasons to do that. I mean, that's the whole point of verses 8 through 11 of this passage. Paul explains why we can have the cheerful heart. And he explains why we can be the cheerful givers. God delights in. He tells us why we can do that. He says in verse 8, "And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all you need, you will abound in every good work." What a great and powerful verse that is. I mean, here's the reason why we can be cheerful givers. Here's the reason why we can sow bountifully. God is able to supply all grace so that in all things, at all times, we will have all we need for every good work. Every good work. God makes our giving possible because he can and he will supply everything we need for our giving. John Piper says, I love this quote, "God will never call you to be a giver of something he will not supply." Let that truth sink in. God will never call you to be a giver of something he will not supply. That is an amazing truth. And that's what this verse 8 here is saying. We will have all we need for every good work that God intends for us to do. God will give it to us. And did you notice Paul's use of the word abound in this verse? He says God is able to make all grace abound to us so that we can abound in every good work. This is bountiful stuff. God doesn't give us just the minimum of what we need so that we can do just enough good. His giving abounds so that we can abound in our giving. His bountiful giving makes us able to be bountiful sowers, abounding in every good work. And his bountiful giving also makes us bountiful reapers. Because of his abounding grace, we will have more as we give more. In all things, at all times, we will have all we need to keep on giving. Knowing that and believing that and trusting that makes us cheerful givers. The kind of givers that God delights in. And the next verse describes a giver like that. Verse 9 is a quote from Psalm 112, verse 9. That's why Paul says there, "as it is written." Psalm 112 is a psalm that talks about a person who trusts God and delights in or takes joy in following God's ways. And it says about that person, Paul says, "as it is written," Psalm 112, verse 9, this is where it says this, "that person, he has scattered abroad his gifts to the poor. His righteousness endures forever." One of the characteristics of this type of person is a person that trusts God, delights in doing his way, and following his ways. One of the characteristics of that type of person is that he sows bountifully. You can kind of see that imagery when the psalmist says he scatters abroad his gifts. This is a generous person, and he sows bountifully. He abounds in every good work. God delights in this person. He is a person who God sees as righteous. It says his righteousness endures forever, which is part of his bountiful reaping. There are great rewards spiritually from being generous. Bountiful sowing also leads to the bountiful reaping of more sow. So not only are there spiritual benefits, but verses 10 through 11 are talking about how bountiful sowing also leads to bountiful reaping of more to sow. Verse 10, "Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be made rich in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion." That's this whole idea, again, of bountiful sowing leading to bountiful reaping. Because of the way it works in the kingdom of God, the more you give, the more you will have to give. You won't have less, you will have more to give. This is a isn't a get-rich kind of idea. It's the idea of it just keeps abounding so we can keep on giving. You can't outgive God. You can't. A couple of weeks ago, a couple of Bethel's members told me how they plan to increase their giving for this holiday season. They felt led to double a special thing that they do to bless others for Christmas. That meant that they would be giving away an extra $500. And I think it was within just 1 week of making that decision that an unexpected check showed up in the mail for $500. You can't outgive God. God bountifully supplied the seed that they felt called to bountifully sow. God supplied what they felt called to give. He supplied and increased their store of seed to enlarge their harvest of righteousness, their harvest of good. They were generously supplied so that they could be generous. You can't outgive God. He is the ultimate cheerful giver. And he does that so that we can be cheerful givers that he delights in. Because our cheerful giving brings him glory. It brings him glory. Verse 11 goes on to say, and through us your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. Our generosity brings God glory. Our generosity causes others to express thanksgiving and praise to God. When others see us doing just the opposite of what we as humans are inclined to do, rather than getting and keeping and spending on ourselves or just reluctantly giving away as little as we can, when they see us cheerfully giving generously because we have overflowing joy in God's grace, it causes them to give praise to God, to give God the glory. They say, what's going on here? Something has made this person different. And look what they're able to do. It brings glory to God. It's God who is the source of it all. It causes them to give God glory, and God loves his glory. He loves his glory. Throughout the Bible, you will see it. For the sake of my glory, I will not share my glory with another. For the sake of my glory, I do this. For the sake of my name, I do this. It's over and over and over in the Bible. God loves his glory because he is glorious. He should love his glory. And so he loves to make it possible for us to be cheerful givers because it results in his glory. So let's go for it. Let's go for it in our lives. Let's embrace the grace of God and be filled with joy that overflows in generosity. Let's be cheerful givers and bring great glory to God. That's what it's all about. Let's pray. Oh God, thank you for your generosity. You are a generous God. Oh, this time of year we pause and say thanks, but every single day we can be giving you thanks for your great generosity to us. Thank you for being the generous God that you are, and help us to be people of generous living. And we live generously. Father, it's not something we're naturally inclined to do. It's hard for us. We think this stuff is so important. We think we need money for security, that we need it for happiness. But you are the ultimate source of security and happiness. And your promises to us say that you will give us all that we need for every circumstance, in all things, in all times, for every good work. You want us to be generous. So forgive us. Forgive us for not trusting. And help us to trust. Help us. We ask for your help, Father, to step forth in faith. Maybe look at our giving and say, I'm going to give more. I'm going to give more. Because I want to see you work, God. I want to see how you supply. Father, you supply and you bless in so many ways. In our, as the verse said, the righteousness. His righteousness endures forever. There are so many blessings to being generous. So help us to see and understand it, comprehend it, and open our eyes to that upside down nature of your kingdom so we can truly, truly live for your glory in our lives. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's stand and let's sing this song that declares how great our God is. Really, when we come to it, down to it, the very breath in our lungs is a gift from Him. So let's sing out His praise.
You give life, You are love, You bring light to the darkness. You give hope, You restore every heart that is broken. Great are You, Lord. It's Your breath in our
to watch over you, and He is inside you to fill you with His power, His peace. Amen.
This is amazing grace. This is amazing.